shock sharp, instead of waiting, I don't know, 3-4 years to implement the economic reform, the economic reform should be introduced over 6 months, or so 3 months, not 3 years. So this is what was, you know, done in Poland. And I think, you know, later on, I ask Professor Onyszkiewicz whether the support of the European Union, you know, how important was support from the European Union for the success of the economic reform in Poland, because introducing shock therapy in Egypt, I think, you know, would be extremely, dangerous and would be extremely risky. The other point, we are talking about, you know, dissolving local councils. So one of the early measures in Poland was also to introduce local government reform, and it was quite drastic because, as the professor has said, this endowed the local councils with full authority. Our local councils have very little authority. I would like just to say that, you know, about the independent judiciary, in Egypt we have so-called sitting judges are independently minded, and in fact they were one force for change. They did the challenge the government in 2005 in order to allow free elections and in order to increase the independence. So the judges in Egypt were not seen as the actual force, but were seen as a force for reform. Now we turn to General Agus Widjojo to tell us about, you know, the transition in Indonesia. He may like to address some of these points, or later on I will ask questions about these points. So please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With my military background, I will focus more on the sector reform aspect of the Indonesian democratic transition. And nothing can be better with the statement of the minister that the military thinks that they know about everything. I think it's a good transition from our presentation. ladies and gentlemen, I fully realize that in any regime of political transformation in any country, that each was, is, and will always be influenced by the unique characteristics of the local conditions. To be able to understand any process or phenomenon, one has to put in context if we are to draw lessons from any processes, and that there is no one size that fits all situation. With that, I think my presentation is more of a storytelling where I will inform you that any democratic transition process is not linear, and sometimes consists of surprises, unintended consequences, and what progress and what did not progress at this point in time. Those are the things that I would like to inform you. First of all, that there are many similarities of the situation between the democratic transition in Indonesia and in Egypt. First of all, is that political transformation, it is a political transformation from an authoritarian into a democratic political system. Secondly, that it started from an economic crisis which spiraled into a multidimensional crisis. In Indonesia, it started with a financial crisis, followed by the breakout of social riots in Jakarta, which led to the resignation of President Suharto. In Egypt also we saw the resignation of President Hosni Mubarak. And I don't know if it was a coincidence or not that President Suharto resigned after his visit to Cairo. So it may be one of those back to the future phenomena. Thirdly, is that both countries are characterized by the many scattered and diverse political groups and movements which have to be accommodated in the new democracy. In Indonesia, the military were highly influential in Indonesian politics before the reform. It was actually a politicized military, and what President Suharto practiced in the civilian control over the military was what Professor Huntington calls as the subjective civilian control over the military, meaning it is the misuse of the military to support a political regime. Compared to the objective civilian control of the military, where we would like to see in a healthy democratic political system in civil military relations. Before the reform, the Indonesian military had the doctrine of the dual function. It stated that the Indonesian military exists not only as a defense and security force, but it also had the role of a socio-political force. To understand this is actually to understand the process of inception of the Indonesian military, where it was created by integrating all the forces during the struggle for independence against the Dutch in 1945. So it integrated the various political or the various armed wings of the political movement then. So it can be said that right from the beginning of its inception, the Indonesian military was already political in nature. And that may be the opposite of the Egyptian military. It had a formal socio-political role based on the Bill number 20 of 1982, as I have just stated. And so it was clear and it was easy to see that one of the objectives of the transition into democracy was to return the Indonesian military to its proper traditional military role of external defense. But when the democratic transition happened or took place in 1998 and 1999, fortunately that the military had voluntarily conducted its own internal reform. It voluntarily withdrew from their socio-political role, where before they had representatives in the parliament, one. They had an active involvement in Indonesian domestic politics and internal security, and by the internal reform of the DNI, they had reformed all these and completely withdraw from their socio-political role. And that left the democratic transition or reform, political reform in Indonesia to the civilian politicians and civil society and various civilian elements of the nation. The military did not have any involvement at all in the Indonesian democratic transition. The changes made by the Indonesian democratic transition was that, first of all, it established the direct election of the various elected public officials from the executive branch of power at the national level and at the regional level, and also in the House of Representatives. Whereas before that, the elected public official in the executive powers were elected by the People's Consultative Assembly, or the legislative body of the Indonesian political system. Now it is directly elected by the people at the executive branch and the legislative branch, whether at the national or the regional level. Secondly, that authorization has been given for wider autonomy for regions, although that Indonesia claims to still have retained the unitary republic of Indonesia, but a wider autonomy has been granted for the regions. Although that in fact it just stopped short of the practice of federalism, but a very wide autonomy is granted to the regions, and a very different arrangement between the central government and the regional government is now in place. Next is the, to reform the role of the military to focus on external defense out of politics, meaning putting the military under civil supremacy, because before that, the post of Minister of Defense is will be assumed by the same person who also assumes the position of the commanding general of the armed forces. So it's a joint assignment. And by the military reform, that was separated, and the Indonesian military launched the change to recognize that the position of the Minister of Defense is a political and civilian position, and since 1999 it has been there has been civilian Minister of Defense for Indonesia. Also, there was a separation of the police from the armed forces. Before reform, the police was part of the armed forces due to political reasons, because in 1965, all armed elements of the Indonesian armed forces were the subject to be co-opted by the various political movements that created the cracks in those various armed institutions in Indonesia. And when President Suharto came to power, he introduced a policy of integrating all the security forces who bears arms into one integrated armed forces, which includes the police as part of the armed forces. The reform in 1998 separated or re-separated the police from the armed forces. And now the military is separated from the police force and has come under the Ministry of Defense, where in the past it was called the Ministry of Defense and Security. Although that the police force is now still positioned directly under the president and would not go under the authority of the elected public official in the region, but it is already separated from the armed forces. Next week, which I would like to inform you is that so those were the objectives that would be clearly seen in the process of the reform of democratic transition in Indonesia, which started in 1998. We found out that that the achievement or attainment of those objectives does not automatically can be said that we are already democratic. Although that we conduct general elections regularly, but we realize that we have entered a more difficult phase of substantive democratic transition. Our challenge is now, after establishing procedural democratic transition, we are now in the phase to face the challenge of establishing substantive democracy, which is not an automatic and linear process. What are those situations that we face that we learn that the process from a procedural to substantive democracy is not a linear process? First, that judiciary and law enforcement to crack down and curb corruption are very weak. Whereas we see that the pillars to enforce a new democracy is an effective law enforcement and judiciary system, we find that that is still weak. Secondly, with the new regional autonomy, we found that not only that governance or the authority of government is to be delegated to the region, but also corruption that spreads to all branches of the government and regions also, and primarily due to the weak law enforcement function. Thirdly, the requirement to deliberate and consult wide spectrum of stakeholders and constituents made decision-making process very slow, if not stagnant, in a democracy. We learned that compared to an authoritarian system, which we felt were more decisive, decision-making process were very slow in the new democracy, and sometimes we see it also as stagnant. This created a new form of frustration amongst the public. And fourth, some segments of the public are starting to refer themselves to the past regime with the characteristics of decisiveness, clear policies, which can mean a lot to security and a better economic well-being. What causes this ambivalence and confusion in the midst of this democratic transition? To my opinion, I would come to the conclusion that actually in a traditional culture or culture of a traditional society, democracy is a foreign commodity. Where in our traditional society, we base ourselves more on communitarianism, togetherness. Democracy bases itself on individuality. More than that, it is responsible individuality. So it is two levels up from what we used to have as communitarianism, and where we base ourselves on leaders. In a traditional society, leadership plays an important role, and we tend to become dependent on leadership. We need leaders to decide our destiny, but also when things go wrong, we need leaders to blame. So individual responsibility is not the strong trademark of a traditional culture. Next also is that I feel that the culture of a traditional society is more of a result-oriented than process-oriented, and where democracy is a process-oriented system. We are not patient to wait for results. What for? To judge the results, who is wrong and who is right. We are not used to be familiar with the process. So winning or losing is a matter of pride for us. There is only one type of winning and there is only one type of losing. We cannot familiarize ourselves like the English Premier League. Yeah. When Arsenal does win the championship this season, there is always next season, there is always other seasons in the future. And they will have to play better to prove that they are worthy champions of next season. So we are not used to that. For us, losing is losing our pride. We have to always win in every single match, and that is impossible. Also, there is that different concept of power. For the traditional society, power is something that is granted from the divine power from above. So it is taken for granted. And the leaders does not feel any responsibility to be accountable and responsible to the constituents because it is taken for granted. And actually, that the followers, the people, are comfortable under authority because they see authority as a divine, a sacred institution. And anything that decides our destiny coming from the sacred institution must be the best for us. So we are not used to question, and we are not used to use our individual rights, because the leader will decide for us what is best for us. Whereas in democracy, the power over followers is only a mandate given by the followers, so that the leader has to be responsible and accountable to the followers. These are transformations, these are changes, which I think is the most difficult and the most challenging in any democratic transition for the culture of a traditional society. And it does not mean that democracy cannot go hand in hand in a traditional society, but it requires education. And it requires that we discipline ourselves to enhance our individual responsibility to adhere to the regulations of those that we have agreed before. But with that, with the gap between the values that we all share in a traditional society and those characteristics and values that are required in a democracy, we should close that gap through education. If not, then what is the importance of closing that gap? It is to understand of what is to be able to be expected from democracy, and what is that we do not expect because it is not promised to be delivered by democracy. For instance, in Indonesia, in this time of ambivalence and confusion in this democratic transition, we often hear that people will say that we need strong leaders, we need strong leaders. We had strong leaders in the leadership of President Soeharto. So why did we dispose of him? But that is because that we are not aware that strong leadership is never promised by democracy. The result of a democracy is always a compromise. So there is no absolute value of what is right and what is wrong. Democracy only promises equality. And if any decision comes from the right source of authority, then that decision, by democratic principles, is legal. Whether it is right or wrong, it will be a political process through the checks and balances and controlled by the parliament. Sometimes, because we are used more to the result-oriented orientation, we tend to ask or we tend to expect that the result of any democratic process is the right answer. And we become frustrated if the result of any democratic process is different from what we expect. So that is what I mean, that it is important to know what can be expected from democracy and what is not promised by democracy. And I'll give you just one last visualization of the milestones of Indonesian democratic transition. In May 1998, President Soeharto stepped down after holding executive power for 32 years. Because the military has withdrawn from the political role, then the transition was left entirely to the civilian politicians. And by that, Vice President B.J. Habibie is sworn in as president, as the new president. In 1999, the first democratic elections since 1955 took place. The first amendment of the Indonesian Constitution also took place, and President Habibie's accountability speech is revoked by the People's Assembly. The Assembly elects Abdurrahman Wahid as president. In August 2000, second amendment of the Indonesian Constitution and a provision was given for the separation of the Indonesian police from the armed forces. In July 2001, President Abdurrahman Wahid is impeached by the People's Assembly. Vice President Megawati Soekarno Putri, the daughter of President Soekarno, is sworn in as president. In November 2001, third amendment of the Indonesian Constitution, provision for direct presidential election and the establishment of regional representative council. In 2002, the fourth amendment of the Constitution, and in 2004, we saw the first direct presidential election with Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono juga the first popular elected president in the history of the Republic of Indonesia. With that, I conclude my presentation and invite your discussion and questions. Thank you very much.
Before we move to the few questions, I just put a few points, and I expect very brief answers, not exceeding 3 minutes for any of you. The history of Indonesia is more relevant to him because President Soeharto was in power. He was the general who took part in military coup in 1965, which ended the regime of President Soekarno and massacred, in fact, almost half the people who were members of the Indonesian Communist Party. And then for 32 years, President Soeharto was the president of Indonesia. And then the East Asian financial crisis put an end to his regime. But one major feature of the regime of Soeharto was corruption. And following the overthrow, his sons and daughters, I think, were put on trial. So I think it is a relevant question to ask, how did, in the case of Indonesia, how did the new regime in Indonesia deal with this question of corruption? I maybe I don't know very well the Polish case, but I don't remember that there was such cases of corruption in the case of Poland. So one issue is corruption. The second issue is relationship between region and state in the two countries. And the third question is, the choice of the post-transition political system, whether it is parliamentary or presidential, and what sort of problems or challenges the two countries have faced. So 3 minutes for each view, but on corruption I can ask only Lieutenant General Agus Widjojo. So how did you deal with the problem of corruption of the Soeharto family?
Yes. How do we deal with the corruption of the Soeharto's family? As I have said, there is no one-size-fits-all situation for that fits all countries. And I think this is difficult to put it in the context that any system transformation or political transformation is never a transformation from black to white completely. There are always remnants or elements of the past regime that are still in the government, and that the new system has not been completely established. Usually also in any democratic transition, the judiciary falls victim because of that situation and becomes ineffective. So while it is always ideal that we push for retributive justice and bring all the corruption cases to court, but in this situation sometimes it's not always possible. And with that comes up the theory and option of restorative justice, and that is reconciliation. Because if we would like to pursue all cases absolutely to be brought to court, how much time would it take? How much would it cost? Would it fulfill that sense of justice? It is a reality. It is not. It is not an excuse, but the reality is such. In restorative justice, the ultimate question is, how do we agree to see the past and close the book, and so that we can start anew as a new society to face challenges of the future. The method can vary from country to country. It can consist of truth-seeking, justice, reparation, and institutional reform. In the end, it would bring more attention as to what went wrong and how to correct the system and how to prevent recurrence of such a situation that we do not want to happen. Indonesia established an independent commission for corruption eradication. Right? Still, that commission, although has been given quite large powers, but still weren't able to satisfy all elements in the society. And whereas that here and there, there were still involvements of the cases that are being resolved by the commission, or that that the cases that are to be processed by the commission could not reach the real big corruption cases. So there is also a question that can reach into our